Are you ready for a midweek recharge? Let's go to Bible study.
Somebody prayed for me, had me on their mind, took the time to pray for me. Somebody prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad somebody prayed for me. My mother prayed for me. She had me on her mind. She took the time to pray for me. My mother prayed for me. I'm so glad she did. I'm so glad my mother prayed for me. My Savior prayed for me. Jesus had me on his mind. He took the time to pray and die for me. My Savior prayed for me. I'm so glad he prayed. I'm so glad he died and prayed for me. Oh, somebody prayed for me. They had me on their mind. They took out time to pray for me. Somebody prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad somebody prayed for me.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Anthony Chadwick, for that song. Praise the Lord. Jesus prayed for me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank God for everyone who prays for us, but ain't nobody prayer like Jesus' prayer. And so that's tonight. We're going to look at that in John's Gospel, chapter 17. And I just want to welcome you to the midweek word this Wednesday night. Hallelujah. I'm just praising the Lord, and I hope you're excited and that your heart is filled with just joy and thanksgiving to God after that song. Hallelujah. Welcome. My name is Minister Willie McNeil, and I am going to lead us in a study tonight, and that's exactly what I'm going to talk about. My Jesus prayed for me. He prayed for you and for me. And we're going to be in John's Gospel, chapter 17, and we'll jump into it because there is absolutely no way I can go through this entire prayer in the time that has been allotted to me. And so tonight I'm just going to pull some thoughts from the scriptures and just share some insight as we explore parts of this prayer. Very powerful prayer called the High Priestly Prayer of Jesus. Some say this is the true Lord's Prayer because the prayer that he taught the disciples, there's no way he could pray that prayer because he doesn't have to ask for forgiveness for his sins. Amen. Amen. So this is, and there's other reasons, but this is the high priestly prayer, the prayer that Jesus prayed. He begins in verse 17, actually praying for himself. And then he kind of flows into praying for his disciples. And then he kind of goes into praying for all that would believe in him because of their word, which includes you and I. And so then we want to take a look at this scripture. In John chapter 17, I'm going to start at verse 6. I'm going to begin at verse 6, and I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. And it reads, I have revealed you to the ones you gave me from the world, from this world. They were always yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything I have is a gift from you. For I have passed on to them the message you gave me. They accepted it, and now that I came from you, and they believe you sent me. Verse 9 says, my prayer is not for the world, but for those you gave me, you have given me, because they belong to you. All who are mine belong to you, and you have given them to me so they bring me glory. Now I am departing from the world. They are staying in this world, but I am coming to you, Holy Father. You have given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name so that they will be united just as we are. During my time here, I protected them by the power of the name you gave me. I guarded them so that none was lost except the one headed for destruction, as the scriptures foretold. Now I am coming to you. I told them many things while I was with them in this world so they would be filled with my joy. I have given them your word. And the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking that you take them out of the world. I am not asking that you take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is true. Listen to this prayer. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. Verse 20 says, I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will believe in me through their message. I pray that they will all be one just as you and I are, as you are in me, Father, and I am in you, and may they be in us so that the world will believe that you sent me. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Jesus prayed for me. Let's pray. Let us have a prayer, time of prayer. Hallelujah. Bless your name, God. Hallelujah. Father, truly, we are grateful and honored and blessed to be together tonight. And Lord, we are grateful to you, God, for your love, for your grace and mercy, and for your goodness. Thank you for keeping us thus far to this point of the week. Thank you for watching over us and caring for us and helping us with life, oh Lord God, each and every day, God. And thank you, God, for your son, Jesus, who not only lived and died that he might give us eternal life, not only did he rise from the dead, but then he ascended back into heaven to sit at the right hand on the throne, oh God, that he might continue to intercede and pray for all the saints. God, we praise you. God, you're truly wonderful and you're truly amazing. And it is truly amazing what prayer can do. And so, Lord, bless us now as we look into your word, as we gather some insight from the scriptures concerning your great son's prayer. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father, and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' holy name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God is so good and he is so gracious and wonderful and amazing and truly, he does great and wonderful and mighty things. And this prayer is so powerful and so deep, and there's so much in this prayer. And so we want to take a look at some of the scriptures. You know, Jesus' prayer is kind of way off from where our prayers would be, you know, because Jesus, you know, he doesn't ask for blessings, and he's not asking for, healing, and he's not praying for money and for good success and things of that nature. But he kind of focuses on, he kind of flows from what he was praying about himself, about his about eternal life, about that the world might know the only true God and Jesus Christ, the one whom you sent to earth. And he's talking about the glory that he gave to God by completing the work that he had done. And then looking forward, you know, he was being nice in front of the disciples, but he probably wanted to say, "Geez, God, I can't wait to get back to heaven with you." You know, and so there's probably some joy in this. This is probably a good, exciting prayer. This is not no down prayer. This is probably an exciting, powerful prayer. And the disciples are right there, the 11, because Judas is not there with them. And the important thing about this prayer is Jesus prayed this prayer because it was a necessary prayer. And it was a prayer that the disciples would need and a prayer that you and I will need as we live in this world. And those are the things that Jesus prayed about. I asked the question, why did Jesus pray for us? Well, one, because he knew that God would hear and answer his prayer. And the other thing is because he knew we needed it. And above all, he knew that these disciples needed it for the work that they were about to embark on, for the life that they were getting ready to live, for the walking by faith that they were getting ready to step into, for the powerful spirit that was going to work in them and work through them, for the great and awesome things that God was about to do in their life. They needed to be one, and they needed to be focused, and they needed to be protected, and they needed to be kept by God. They needed to continue in the word and continue to believe. And they were going to have to endure the hatred of the world because they were in the world, but not of the world. The word of God had already had its effect on their lives. They had been changed. They had been transformed. They had believed that God, the Father, had loved the world and had sent Jesus into the world to die. They believed that Jesus had the words to eternal life. And so now as Jesus is preparing to leave and preparing to send them to begin the great work of starting the church, Jesus knew that they needed his prayer. And all who would believe in him was in great need of his prayer. This is a great scripture that assures us of that when Jesus prays for us, he's praying specifically for exactly what we need. Notice in verse 8, he says, "For I have passed on to them the message you gave me. They accepted it and know that I came from you, and they believe you sent me. My prayer is not for the world, but for those you have given me because they belong to you." So listen, Jesus is specifically praying for his disciples, and they are in great need of this prayer. And notice the things that he did pray for about them. You know, he talked about them being in the world and not of it, being hated by the world. He prayed about them being kept from the evil one. He prayed about them being sent into the world, and he prayed about them revealing Jesus to the world. He had some specific requests, and that God would use his name that he had given them to protect them. And he said that he also let the things that I have told them fill them with joy. And he also asked God that he would sanctify them. And here's the thing that I'm going to kind of flow into is, and he says that you make them one. Make them one. And that right there is the thing. Jesus' great desire for all believers is that they be one. He wanted us to be united as a powerful witness to the reality of God's love. And so when you think about these disciples and you think about this 11 and his word that he had given to them, they were willing to obey everything that Jesus had told them to do. And you see this unity in them as they go to the day of Pentecost. They are there on one accord. They are all praying and they are all waiting for the promise of the Holy Spirit. They are waiting. Jesus gets ascended up into heaven and they are all praying on one accord, waiting for Jesus to come. And so once they receive the Holy Spirit, you see that Peter begins to preach. And they begin the great work that God has called them to do. And immediately they already start getting some flack from people that are witnessing this experience that they are having with God and receiving the power of the Holy Spirit. And so Peter begins to preach and souls are beginning to be saved by the multitudes, okay? But they don't glory in that. They don't get excited and overdone. They just start discipling. They start doing exactly what Jesus did. They start giving them the word, teaching them, helping them to understand the joy that they're going to need to face the persecution, helping them to understand that God is going to protect them and that God is going to keep them. You know, they start just making disciples and discipling believers and developing church and relationships. And that's what we have to do. Paul said in Ephesians chapter 1, he says, therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. You see, that right there is a good start for a church. The people was telling Paul and others about their faith in Jesus and their love for all the saints. Well, let me ask you something. Do you have love for all the saints? When you think about church, when you go to church, most people, they go to the church and they look at the pastor and they want to see who the first lady is, you know, in black churches. And they want to, see if they like them and if they like what they're talking about and how they carry themselves and all this stuff like that. But the truth of the matter is you should be already set. If God spoke to you and he said that this is where he wants you to be and this is where he wants you to serve him, look, you have to love not just the pastor and his wife, you have to love the whole church. You have to be seeking to become one with the entire church. You have to have love for all the saints. You have to become one with them to accomplish the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ in the world, to be a witness. You're going to need the saints of God who are united with one purpose, and that is to glorify God by completing the work that he has called them to do. And that's what Jesus did. That's what his example was. And it is the same with us. We glorify God when we complete the work that he has called us to do. And so it's important that you recognize that when Jesus prays for us, his prayer has purpose, and his prayer is that whatever, at the end of what we do, that we would glorify God. Think about these disciples. Many of these very disciples that are sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to his teachings from chapter 13 to 16, are soaking up all this word. And then in 17, Jesus begins to pray for them. And many of the things that he's talked to them about, he's now praying about, that it might fulfill, that it might be accomplished in their lives. Listen, only God could make these things happen, these things. Only God could help cause us to not to be in the world, but not of it, and successfully live a sanctified life unto him. Only God could make us one in him and in one another, united in the purpose of revealing Jesus to the world. only God could cover us and protect us from the devil, all that he seeks to do to steal, kill, and destroy, all the tricks and traps and deceptions and temptations that he attacked the people of God with, all the things that he do so that, and all the things that he'll do to cause people to rise up against you to try to hinder you from doing the work God called you to be, from living the life that God has called you to live. Those are the things. In Luke chapter 21, verse 17 and 21 through 21, it says, and everyone, listen to this, it says, and everyone will hate you because you are my followers, but not a hair on your head will perish. By standing firm, you will win your soul. Listen, that means you're going to be victorious in the end. In the end, you're going to be victorious. In the end, you're going to be in the presence of the Father and in the presence of Jesus, experiencing their glory after all that you have done. Why? Because not a hair of your head is going to perish, because God is going to protect you. Do you have love for all the saints? Do you trust the people of God that you are serving with? Do you pray for them? Do you extend the love of Jesus? Do you encourage them to not fall into sin and not fall away, but continue in the faith? Do you trust God to protect you as you go forward in his name to do the things that he has called you to do? Those are the things that Jesus prayed about. Those are the challenges that we as believers in Christ face as we live in this world, as we seek to walk by faith, as we seek to fulfill the work that he has called us to do. These disciples walked with Jesus, and they had experienced attacks even while they were with Jesus. But while they were with Jesus, they didn't suffer any harm. But after, when they went out to serve and fight and serve and share the gospel, they faced lots of opposition. One of the things that this scripture says in Luke chapter 20, it says that you'll be betrayed even by your own family, your own loved ones. You know what I'm saying? And that's what the enemy will do. He will cause people to come up against you simply because you love Jesus. But God's protection is certain. It's a sure thing. You can trust in it and to depend on it. Jesus warned them about the coming persecutions that they would happen, that would come upon them. He warned them about it, but the good news is they were comforted because they knew and trusted that he would protect them. They could be strong and courageous no matter how difficult the situation. Some of these disciples, they faced, they were beaten, they were threatened, you know, they were put in prison, and they were told to stop preaching in that name or else. But they would not. Why? Because they trusted that God was going to take care of them. They were going to protect them. They knew, Peter knew, Paul knew that they was going to die, that they was going to be a martyr, that they were going to be murdered because of their faith in him. But yet that didn't stop them. And so that's the thing about what I want to encourage us with tonight. Because in this world, you're going to have tribulation and trouble. And the more you draw near to God and you come on that side of his word, the more sanctified your life is, the more your light will shine. The more you live out the word of God, the more your light is going to shine. You don't even have to say nothing. People will see the anointing of God on your life. People will see the Spirit of God in your life. People will see that light in you because of the joy that is in you, because of the power that is in you, because of the way you carry yourself. They will see the difference. They will see the difference. And some will leave you alone. Some won't care. Some will be happy. Some will ask for your help. It don't matter what the situation is. We have to remain faithful. The other thing is God's protection is sure. It is a protection that keeps us for all eternity. Jesus was not saying that believers would not experience physical harm or even death, as I just mentioned. But what he was saying that even while you're on earth, that you're going to be kept even to eternal life. And just as Jesus had that opportunity to go back to the Father, now you and I are going to have that opportunity when it's all said and done. But here's the thing. You want to finish the work that God has called you to do. You want to complete the work that God has called you to do. And you need the other brothers and sisters in Christ, the believers in Christ, to fulfill that work. And it begins with a right relationship with God. One of the things that we have to do is you have to learn how to discern the voice of God. You got to understand that having a conversation with God is a part of the relationship that you have with God. And God will instruct you and tell you what to do. Don't be like the children of Israel who came out of Egypt, that first generation. When God tried to speak with them at the mountain, even Moses was trembling at the voice of God. And Moses had already spoken to God before. But it was so forceful and powerful, but the people rejected God. They didn't want God to talk to them. They said, you talk to God, Moses, and then tell us. And that didn't work. And it won't work. You have to have a right relationship with God for yourself. Only through your relationship with God and His Word having its impact and transformation in your mind and heart are you going to be able to love the saints. Are you going to be able to know what God is calling you to do? And you're going to have the ability and the confidence that God is going to protect you. When God told Paul to go and preach, he knew that he was going. This might be the last time he preached. He was just rejected and threatened and beaten. And he said, be of good courage. I'm going to send you somewhere else to preach. And on his way, he ran into seven prophetesses, a man who had seven daughters, and they were beautiful women, and they were prophetesses. And they spoke about Paul going to preach and that he was going to die there. And the people were upset. They were sad. They were crying. But Paul told them to calm down. He says, you know what? I'm still going. I'm still going to do what God had called me to do. But you can't reject the relationship with God. You can't. So what happened was that the children of Israel, they rejected God speaking to them. And automatically they're dictating to God what the relationship is going to be like. Jesus said, they have received your word and they believe that I have sent you. You know what I'm saying? We have to receive God's word and His instructions. We don't tell God how we're going to serve Him. We submit and say, God, I'm going to obey you. I'm going to do what you called me to do. I'm going to walk by faith. I'm going to love the saints. I'm going to pray for my enemies and do good to them. I'm going to be a light in this world. I'm not going to be of this world. I'm not going to act like this world. I'm not going to continue in sinful lifestyles and habits. I'm not even going to agree with the sins of this world. I'm going to live a righteous and holy life. And you got to be strong. Let me tell you, there's this guy on my job and he's a believer in Christ. He's one of those believers that still curse. Some of y'all might curse too. He still curses, but he's a good guy, and he knows I'm a believer, and he knows I'm a believer in Christ as well. And he was talking to me, and he was telling me that he went on vacation and he had spent some time at the beach. And you know, we're just talking, but all of a sudden, he's telling me he switched gears and he's telling me this story. And there I am, and we're laughing, and I'm gritting my teeth at the same time. Because he told me this story, an experience that he had. It was a funny experience, but it was also very sinful. And, you know, he's sharing this experience and thing that he did and was doing while he was on vacation. And I'm like, man, you can't be doing that. And so you have to encourage the believers and the saints to do what is right. And you also have to receive from the saints of God when you need to be corrected in doing what is right in the sight of God. And there are some lifestyles and some things that we just cannot do. We cannot participate in them. Those are the old man lifestyles, and we have to walk in the new man's lifestyle. And Jesus said, the scriptures say that people are going to be concerned that we no longer walk with them in those ways. We no longer participate in those types of sins and lifestyles and whatever those experiences are. Change life. These disciples lived a sanctified life. That means set apart. It means holy. Make them holy. He says in verse 17, he says, make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word. This is Jesus's prayer. He's asking the Father. Yeah, we got preachers and all this stuff like that, but it's through God that we are taught the word of God. It's through God that he gives us what we need. You're sitting in church and the word is going forth and it's connecting. You're understanding it. And the Spirit of God is convicting you. And you're saying, you're looking around to the right and to the left, and you're wondering if everyone else is hearing that. And you look at your spouse and they acting normal, looking at their phone, and you look at the kids and they doing something too. And you look at the man in front of you and he's excited about the word, and you're wondering, are you hearing this? But God is speaking to you. That word is for you. And you can't try to put what God is speaking to you on someone else. You can't do what someone else, God is going to work on them and speak to them. But when God speaks to you, you have to own that word. When he's teaching you something, it's for your transformation. It's for your obedience. It's for you to live it out. It's for you to go and do maybe. But that word is for you. Teach them your truth. And just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. Man, I'm out of time. Listen. Love the saints. Live a sanctified life. And obey the Father. Trust in him that he's going to protect you as you live this life. Listen, loving the saints means that you're doing good to the saints. It means that you're not listening to gossip, but you're listening to good things. Paul heard about their faith in Jesus Christ, and he heard about their love for the saints. He said, that's a good start for the church. I'm going to keep them in my prayers. I thank God for people like that. And that's how we should be. You should thank God for holy and righteous people. People that's going to be an example. People who are going to encourage you in your faith. People who are going to lead the way so that you can follow. People who are going to unite with you so that you can glorify God by doing all that he's called you to do. Thank God that Jesus prayed for you and I. Thank God for this prayer. I encourage you to read through this prayer, read it again, meditate on it, think about it, recite some of it. Like you recite the Lord's Prayer, recite some of this prayer. Let it get deep in your spirit. Let it encourage you and empower you and motivate you to want to be all that God has called you to be. Hallelujah. Jude 24 and 25 says this. Now, all glory to God, who is able to keep you from falling away and will bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. All glory to him who alone is God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. All glory, majesty, power, and authority are his before all time and in the present and beyond all times. Amen. Forever, forever. We are kept by God. Hallelujah. We are kept by God. And God is able to keep us from deception of the devil. and the people of this world that could cause us to fall away. We look forward. Your heart should look forward. And as you face trouble and struggles in this life, as you serve the Lord, as you live this new life in Christ, you have to understand that eternal life is awaiting in his presence, where you will glorify him forevermore, where I will glorify him forevermore. Praise the Lord and thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ and his prayer for us. Thank you, Father, for loving us, for keeping us, for teaching us. Thank you for preparing a place for us, that where you are, we will be also. Father God, we are so glad that we believe in you, in your Son Jesus, whom you have sent to die in our place. And we thank you that he rose from the dead. You raised him from the dead, and that he ascended to heaven at your right hand. And he is continuing the work of interceding for the saints, that we might fulfill all that you have called us to do, that we might have his joy, and that we might look forward to heaven. Bless us, God, each and every day, God, to walk by faith and not by sight, to rejoice and have good cheer and joy because you have overcome the world, and acknowledge that we are world overcomers. And that, Lord God, nothing will hinder us if we keep our eyes stayed on you, if we keep trusting in you, if we keep obeying you. Nothing will hinder us from being who you called us to be and completing the work you have given us to do. Bless your people. Bless every believer, God, in Christ Jesus. And help them, oh Lord God, to, Lord, walk in the victory, the same victory that Jesus walked in and the disciples walked in, and the joy that they experienced when they saw you face to face. We love you and honor you today, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. But thank you so much for joining us tonight. Maybe you say, I don't have a relationship with the Lord. I have never accepted him as my Savior. I know that I don't have the gift of eternal life. And I want to have that experience, that faith in Jesus Christ, and that love for the saints, and to know God, the only true God who saves and gives eternal life. You can know him as your Lord and Savior. I want to pray a prayer. And if you repeat this prayer and believe in your heart, the Lord Jesus, and that God had raised him from the dead, the Bible says that you'll be saved. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I humbly come before you, O God. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I need to be saved. I believe that Jesus died for my sins and took my place. I believe that you raised him from the dead and that he is sitting victoriously at your right hand. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I turn away from them and I accept you as my Savior and my Lord. I ask you to fill me with your Spirit and guide me for the rest of my days. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, even now, if you pray that prayer, you are now a born-again believer and you have the gift of eternal life. Go to our website, if you don't mind, and click on the Contact Us tab and fill out that information. Let us know that you accepted Christ for the very first time. And we would love to contact you and share with you the next steps of what it is to be a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and find a local church where the saints will love on you and help you fulfill all that God has called you to do. God bless you and go in peace.
Thank you for joining us. We pray that this message was edifying and encouraging. To request more information about Nations Forward, visit nationfort.org and click on the contact link. You can view information about our ministry, children and youth activities, give, download previous messages, and download our church app. We invite you to join us this Sunday for our remote life enrichment groups. click on the LED icon on our homepage. Then join us on site or online at 10:15 a.m. for our worship celebration. Have a safe and blessed week.